Thanks, Vern. Welcome you all, and it's a pleasure seeing you all here today. Today we are going to look into the topic for today is increasing riders' safety in constrained bikeways by simulating non-motorized vehicle maneuvers. I'm sure many of you have heard about TransAuv. You all have used AutoTurn in the past? Oh, wonderful. Great. So we're going to look into how AutoTurn helps, especially with vulnerable road users today, and what tools are now available in AutoTurn for that. So before we dive into it, it's very important to know who exactly are vulnerable road users. So they are classified as users, as basically they don't have a shield which will protect them when a crash occurs. So basically making them vulnerable, to fatalities and injuries. So the definition includes, as you can see there, a cyclist and even wheelchair users, and pedestrians, the regular pedestrians, and also people working for roadways inside, that you see on the streets. And also wheelchair users, I just wanted to also re-emphasize that. So they face unique challenges when they come across accessing infrastructure, especially non-inclusive infrastructure. So they don't have dedicated lanes, they have to share their, with existing road users. So all these challenges, they face has an implications on their health risk, reduced mobility, and also it has also an economic impact, Why is that? Because then less users are there, to take in part of the economic activity in that city or the town, So that's another aspect of that. Now, an important question is why these users really matter. So this is statistics from WHO. I mean, I wouldn't call this kind of information, I just put it on the screen. In 2021, there were 1.3 million deaths from road fatalities, And of these, 50% of them were vulnerable road users. So as you can see here, some of the numbers here, around nearly 376,000 were motorcyclists. And 311, again, data from 2021, and nearly 40,000 from cyclists. Now, after the pandemic, a couple of things, there has been increased usage with people wanting to use non-motorized vehicles. There has been a big uptick in people wanting to use bicycles. So you can see 30% Canadians who cycle at least occasionally have increased since after the time of the pandemic. Not only bicycles, but e-scooters and e-bikes that are making ridership easier for all sort of demographics. The chart on the right shows the bicycle participants in the U.S. from 2010 to 2021. As you can see, it's kind of growing up. So what that represents is a significant shift in growth in ridership and the use of more sustainable means of transport. And when you look at this chart, one thing you need to understand is this kind of shows the cyclist fatalities in selected countries. There's an uptick in the fatalities because the reason being there are now more people using non-motorized vehicles, including bicycles. So that shows in the US on the red. And as you can see, there are some more fatalities involving them. Now, when you come to the current trends in cycling, so there have been, changes, especially with street design and under complete street policies. There has been a study done by the National Complete Street Coalition, and where they analyzed 37 projects that incorporated bike lanes, okay? And the important thing to notice is this project had implemented traffic calming measures there, And things like they widen the sidewalks, they improved bicycle and pedestrian crossing. And they, what they found is, these projects showed a 70% reduction in collision. There were some projects, this projects involved increase in the number of collision involving bicycles. That's because a lot of improvements have been made, and because of that, a lot of people started using bicycles. And so there were like an uptick in the volume of users using bicycles. So these projects attracted new ridership of new users wanting to take advantage of the new infrastructure. So that's one of the reasons why there were more collisions happening, especially with bicycles. Now, countries like Australia, they're kind of including new mobility devices like e-bikes and e-scooters. And they show the growth in fatalities, and that growth is, well, as you can see there, from comparing to 2018 to 2020, again with associated with the mobility types and the ridership. Okay, coming to, I'm sure all of you are familiar with auto turns. So coming into your use auto turn. So just to understand what exactly is swept path analysis and how it's going to help here. Now, swept path analysis, as you can see there, it evaluates and calculates the space required when a vehicle performs turning maneuvers. One important thing here is the off-tracking. So off-tracking defined by FHWA is the difference in the path between the front and the rear wheels of the vehicle. Okay, and the magnitude of that is based on the wheel base or the space between the front and the rear axles. So, as you can see on the screen, you can see the off-tracking there. You know, it's basically that specific area there. Now, there are two ways of off-tracking. One is off-tracking at low speeds, and off-tracking is high speed. Important thing to remember is off-tracking is bigger at lower speeds, up to 70 kilometers, and beyond that, it's mainly an outswing. So as you can see there, on both these graphs, that's at a lower speed, and at a higher speed, it's mostly an outswing there. Now, the purpose of swept path analysis to help ensure design can accommodate vehicle needs during operation and to ensure that specific design vehicles can maneuver through the selected routes. So in case of vulnerable road users, how could we use that to our advantage? So in AutoTurn Pro, we have capable of producing low speed maneuvers now for known motorized vehicles. So there are some requirements for these vehicles. As you can, this is a snapshot of that. So there are some requirements for these vehicles that they can only reach certain speeds, and they kind of vary from country to country. So now we are now able to capable of simulating these vehicles. As you can see, you might think that is quite simple, but it's not simple enough. They can be quite complex when modeling swept paths. So we're going to look into why. So, so the most part, when you're simulating incorporating guidelines for bike lanes, the concept probably you might have in mind is, should be straightforward, right? Sorry. You have a given width, and that width is intended to accommodate the vehicles, similar to a truck or a bus or a passenger car. Now, there's a significant difference there when dealing with bicycle simulation. Okay, I'll explain a little bit more on that. So the difference is when you come to steering. So when you steer, bicyclists kind of lean to steer, as you can see, they go in making a turn. So that's very important. And that's one of the main difference, as the space required during a turn is different here. The other element that is significant is the rider box, that's again defined by ASHTO, that is specified in the bicycle guideline. So performing swept path analysis involving non-motorized vehicles, including bicycles, can be complex due to their shapes and behavior, as they can steer, but here they also lean to steer. Now, there are cases where due to space constraints, you may not have to deviate from those guidelines. So some examples from, kind of pulled it up from the web. Tight turns and congested cities. So some example on the top left corner. You can see that that's from New York City and from taken from Google Maps. You have specific constraints regarding space, and the turns are tighter, and we are trying to incorporate bike lanes. So in those cases, you might have to deviate from the guidelines to accommodate a little bit, and then look at the safest option to check for swept path of those vehicles. Make sure they can still use the infrastructure safely. That's very important, and the desired speed for those bike lanes. Now, coming to simulating, I think I mentioned earlier, bicycles, even though autoturn is capable of simulating two-wheel vehicles, with wheelbase, there are significant differences when you're dealing with bicycles. These are captured here, as you can see there. And you can see that besides the fact that the bicycles move slower, and they don't have engine, their behavior is significantly different when it comes to steering. Now, they can steer the same as motorized vehicles, but they also lean to steer, which help in the steering and thus making the maneuver smoother. This is the main difference when you are simulating bicycles, okay? So just wanted to kind of mention here. And you know, you can just see, I'll just go back a little bit. So that's like steering and learning, you know, lean to steer, and also you can see the rider box is also part of the vehicle body. Let me just show you how this works in autoturn. Okay, so before I jump into it, with the latest release of autoturn, we now have a library that supports bicycles. These are some of the standard bicycles that are now included, the ASHTO pulled up from the ASHTO bicycle design guideline. And we have included a little bit more. As you can see, there are some different types of new types of bicycles that are now you can use it with an autoturn. So these include mopeds there, scooters, as you can see there, e-scooters, as you can see there. So you have most common and also some challenging types of non-motorized vehicles available for you. I don't have a video, but I thought I'll just quickly show you that in micro station there. Okay. So, you're familiar with autoturn, all of you, so just what's new there. If I open up the vehicle library, that opens up, you can see that we now have the ASHTO vehicle library now included. Now, a couple of things you might be interested to learn a little bit more. So when I click on the vehicle details, it opens up the vehicle details dialog box, and there you can see that you have the wheelbase with the distance from the handlebar, all those details there. And when I click on this button to view more, it'll kind of show me more additional details that has been pulled up from the ASHTO guideline there, like the rider box height. If I can just kind of move my cursor there, you know, the physical width of the rider there, and that's the pedal width, the pedal height, as you can see. So these are now all included in the autoturn, you know, the latest version. Just going to close that. So that's like a quick view. And if I kind of pick up another vehicle, like the bicycle with the cargo trailer there, look at its details there. You can see that's also got two parts there, which I can preview them, see them in autoturn. So that's the part of the main bicycle, and also if I kind of move there, you can also see the part that's a cargo trailer also modeled there for you. Okay, so before we jump in, let's look into how to quickly place a bicycle simulation within the drawing. Important thing is to just explain how we do that. So this is a small drawing that I pulled up for this session. We will try to place a bicycle, you know, and that's the bicycle path there. So let's look into how to do that. So here what we do is, as you're all familiar, use the 2D arc path. And I'm not sure if you all No, you can now, this particular tool called align a geometry. So I can align, you know, when I place a vehicle, I can align that to an existing geometry. So I can come here, click on this, and then align it. So, you know, I'm going to pick that geometry, and as you can see, that as I move around, it kind of aligns with that geometry there. Okay, so I'm going to just place that to the first point. And a couple of things to remember here. As I place there, you can see a few important things there. You can see there is a lean angle, which is kind of showing us 20 degree. You can see the transition time is just 1 second. If you're familiar, the transition time is basically the time take to turn the wheel from one right to the left. You know, so here for bicycles, they actually turn quite quickly. So you can see that's 1 degree that's kind of mentioned there. And the steering lock angle is 20.4 degrees there. So important thing. And let me just quickly place, and as I kind of place around there, you know, I'm just kind of moving it around with my cursor. You can see how the bicycle tends to lean to steer, okay? So you can see that's now how it impacts that envelope as it kind of leans to steer. Quickly, I'll do one thing. I'll just kind of make the speed as maybe 10 miles per hour and just kind of simulate it quickly around this drawing. And you can see how the swept path is kind of generated there. Just go a little bit to that side. And you can see as it makes that turn, it kind of tends to lean to steer. And I'll just come here and then probably reduce my speed. So I'm going to make a left turn from there. So I'm going to kind of make it 5 miles per hour. And I'm going to pick up, use the, instead of the forward arc path, I can come and use the corner path. So you can have the generate corner path. And I'm going to steer to the left. So here in this case, I have the option to now sweep by an angle, or I can pick up an existing element and use that as an angle. So I'm going to kind of sweep along this line. And as you can see that I can place my, and then continue around there. Okay, so that's, just wanted to show you how the envelope is different here, you know, so.
Could I ask you, so the red line is what you put in, but the blue area is anywhere where the cyclist could be within that space in this.
Exactly.
So the, they may be leaning outside of that blue area.
Right. Okay, I'm going to show you one more thing here. I'll just go jump into this particular part of the drawing. So you can also have different envelopes there. Okay, so in this case, it was just the body envelope that was kind of showing there. So when I come to this place, I thought I'll just show you this thing. We have another example here, which I thought I could highlight. So we have kind of some, so the bicyclist is supposed to use this particular lane, and you have kind of has some physical channels, you know, so basically what doesn't want him to maneuver out of it. So we're going to try to maneuver around that area. And we're going to use the same 2D arc path. We're going to kind of align the vehicle. And we're going to place that here. And as you can see there, you can have different envelopes. In this case, this is just the body envelope. I can come here and offset my handlebars, you know, so I can say, you know, offset from the handlebar 1 foot on each side, and I can have a look at a different envelope. So when I have that offset on the handlebar, you can see that small dotted line showing you at the top, okay? So I can have that as now as an envelope to kind of look into, you know, and include in my simulation. Now here, the important thing is with auto tune, you can also look for conflicts. So in this case, I said earlier, that's kind of a 3D kind of a physical structure that's kind of put in there just to kind of channel that bicycle along that lane. So if I move around, as you can see there, you know, when I'm too close to that channel there, you know, or probably to that element there, it'll actually kind of highlight it for me and shows that, hey, you know, there's a conflict. So this is an important thing, you know, you might want to check for tight turns, and you have areas where there are structures around, you want to kind of, you can do that. Now, and this particular, with the conflict analysis tool, you can analyze all that in auto turn. Just quickly show that, I'm going to just kind of maneuver a little bit. It's a little bit challenging to stand here and do, but I thought I can just do it. So I'm just So similarly, kind of making a quick turn there, just thought I'll show you the conflict analysis part of bicycle simulation, and you can see there are conflicts that are detected there, and you can see, you can see quickly show that. I can have offset of the handlebar, I can have the offsets from the head, or also have include the offset thing from the pedal. You know, you can just define the distance, how much it has to go. All right, so that's the quick overview of, just want to show the tool that's available for you in Auditon and how we can now simulate non-motorized vehicles in Auditon, and quite useful, especially when you have projects that includes non-inclusive, you know, modes of transport. Come back to the last few slides. So I think I mentioned that. Just want to.
Sure.
You mean from that?
Drawing your path, can you just tell it?
Oh, okay.
I want to go off this alignment, but I really
want to kind of offset.
Yeah, just.
You can?
Sense.
Can you do that?
Yes.
Okay. Michael is our product from the product management specialist team, so.
I did,
so I brought him here just to answer any, you know, more technical questions there. Okay, just wanted to mention we have the. All the latest ASH tool guidelines built into the software. We are actually updating it as and when new guidelines come out. So as you can see there, and we also include guidelines for, in addition to the US, we have guidelines from TAC Canada, and also we include specific guidelines from Mexico. Wanted to show here. And also, within Auditon, we have guidelines from Europe, from Netherlands, UK, and Denmark. You are free to, you know, nothing stopping you from using all those libraries available in Auditon. So just wanted to kind of mention all this here. And finally, with Australia also, we do have guidelines from Osroads included in the Auditon version 11. This is included in Auditon Pro. Sorry, I forgot to mention that. So all the simulations that you saw with bicycle simulation are actually done in 3D but projected into a 2D drawing. So you need to have the Auditon Pro, okay? Because only the Auditon Pro can do the conflict analysis and all that you saw there. Any questions? You're talking about disadvantages?
Say that again?
Can you repeat? Was it a specific?
Are there any advantages or disadvantages to using the adaptive simulation?
I don't think so. I haven't heard about that. You're still free to use the adaptive simulation even for bicycles there. But the good thing about adaptive simulations, like Vern had mentioned, you can actually specify, you know, from an element, offset it by a certain distance and do the simulation. So that's.
Yeah, so typically, you know, design.
Have you, anyone tried out the Auditon 11 and the bicycle tools? Not yet. Do you find it useful in some of your projects going forward?
It would have been really handy if my first project was an actual bikeway along
okay.
US 36 in Colorado.
Right. So,
we're usually putting bike lanes in very constrained corridors.
Right.
So we're doing what we can with what we have.
Yeah.
So,
That was a challenge. Now you have some tools available. And we would like to get your feedback, because a lot of times that helps us develop the product. And, you know, please reach out to us.
I would say that one of the things to consider is that, you know, your speed was an input in there.
Yeah.
And your speed, it's almost like you got to get bicycle predicted speed in different,
yeah.
Different.
That's true.
Miles per hour. I mean, you could get them really going
That's true.
The other one. So I think those factors are something that we have the speeds there, but those factors can change the analysis.
Yeah, I totally agree to that. Yeah. And if you want to look into places like New York City, nobody's going to go at 20